Hi, I'm Iain, and today we're going to build this English wheel. An English wheel is an old metal shaping machine that is actually pretty simple. It's made up of three main parts. The first part, and the biggest part, is the frame itself. It needs to be rigid enough to hold these two wheels tightly together and squash the panel into submission. By smushing the metal between the two wheels, it curves in two directions. That's what the frame's job is, to hold it all together. The next thing is the adjustment mechanism. It needs to have some mechanism to it that can change the pressure of the wheels. Now, there's two main styles of adjustment mechanisms, and they're basically the same thing. It just has to do with which spot it's in. This is an upper adjuster. It's named an upper adjuster because it adjusts the top wheel up and down, and it has a hand wheel up at the top. The other style you'll see are lower adjusters, which have the wheel on the bottom and they adjust the lower die, which is what they usually refer to the lower wheel as, up and down. The benefit of the lower adjuster is if you make a wheel that has little spokes to it, you can actually kick it while you're working the panel and adjust the pressure of the rollers on the fly. I'm not that skilled with an English wheel where I can actually work the panel and kick a kick adjuster with my foot at the same time. Maybe I'll get there someday, but not right now. So to me, it made more sense to have the upper adjuster. So you've got the frame, the adjustment mechanism. Finally, you need the actual wheels that are going to shape the metal. The upper wheel, usually referred to as an anvil, is perfectly flat. Its job is basically just to smush the metal against whatever shape wheel you have on the bottom. The wheel on the bottom is usually referred to as the die, and they come in various shapes depending on what type of shape you're trying to put in the panel. As the panel becomes more and more curved, you have to go to a lower die that is more and more curved, because otherwise you can actually start hitting the edge of the die in the curve of the panel and you get what's known as wagon tracks, where you'll actually see tracks from the outer edges. So you need wheel on the bottom, wheel on the top. In this case, I did not build these wheels. This upper wheel is a 3-inch wide metal ace wheel. It's a very nice wheel. I purchased it, and while I was talking to the person on the phone at Metal Ace, I asked them if they happened to have any of these upper yokes to go with it, and they did. So I purchased the upper yoke and the mounting plate for the upper yoke. So essentially, right here, this is all from Metal Ace. The lower dies I bought from Eastwood, because that was the best price I could find for a set of lower dies. The lower dies are 2-inch wide, the upper wheel is 3-inch wide, and I did that deliberately. The reason for that is someday, if I want, I can purchase a set of 3-inch wide metal ace lower dies and make a new lower die holder that's 3 inches wide, and they'll work with the wider upper wheel. The skinnier dies also work just fine with the upper wheel. Wider dies would not work with a narrower upper wheel. So if you're going to have a mismatched size, you want the upper wheel to be the biggest you're ever going to use. While I bought the upper yoke, we're going to make the lower die holder. So if you see how I built this lower yoke, it's basically the same thing, just flipped upside down for the top. Speaking of building things, we're going to build this upper adjuster, we're going to build this lower die holder, we're going to build the frame, the stand, Not going to build the casters, going to buy the casters, because it just makes sense. All this stuff was built out of recycled metal. If you have a scrapyard nearby, or even, say, half an hour away, it is well worth it to go there and see if you can get scrap metal. Because this frame is made out of sprinkler pipe out of an old building. It's some 1-inch diameter pipe, some 2.5-inch pipe, and some 4-inch diameter pipe. That saved me pennies on the dollar right there, using old sprinkler pipe. Same with the legs and the lower die holder and the upper adjuster. It was all square tubing from who knows what, but clean it up a little bit and it works perfectly fine for this, and it's a fraction of the price of brand new steel. One more thing to say about this assembly before we get into actually building it. The upper adjuster bolts onto the top of the frame using these two plates. One plate is welded to the frame, one plate is welded to the upper adjuster, and I use 6 bolts to bolt it together. It's the exact same arrangement down here to bolt on the lower die holder. And I did that for a reason. The reason is, if I ever have to do work on this upper adjuster, or someday I decide I want a fixed upper wheel and a lower adjuster, well, it makes it really easy to take this apart. I just unbolt it, and I can bolt whatever else on it I want. Same thing with the bottom. Someday, if I do decide to upgrade to 3-inch wide lower dies, I need to make a 3-inch wide lower die holder. Well, instead of cutting this one off and then welding the new one back on, the easiest thing to do is just unbolt this one, set it aside with the 2-inch lower dies, and bolt the 3-inch one on. And if someday I want to go back to the 2, I just unbolt that one, bolt this one back on. So that's why it's got bolt-on pieces here and here. Also, there's one other reason. I wasn't sure how accurate I was going to be able to get these plates in alignment. So I figured if worse came to worse, I could use pieces of sheet metal or box board or paper, whatever, in between these two to shim them one way or the other if I had to. So it didn't come to that, but if it had, I was ready for it. So that's another thing to think about. Without further ado, let's go ahead and start building this English wheel. This is the biggest piece of pipe I could find. It's a 4-inch diameter, schedule 40, regular metal pipe. What I did is I cut a 45-degree angle on it. I wanted to do that first because I find it difficult to lay things out on round pipe, especially a 45-degree angle, because until I cut it, I don't know where the shortest end is going to be. Now that that's cut, I'm going to trim it to length. I want the horizontal piece of the C, which is what this is, to be 36 inches from the edge of the lower wheel to the inside of the neck of the big C frame. So I've got it set up in my horizontal bandsaw. It's 36 inches from the edge of the blade over here to the short section of the 45, and we will go ahead and cut it. Unfortunately, this bandsaw hits right here on top of here, so it can't cut all the way through. It leaves about a 16th of an inch at the bottom of the pipe. But what I found I can do is just pull the pipe out a little bit and rotate it and cut the last little bit with the hacksaw. This is still a lot faster and a lot easier with the bandsaw and a little bit of hacksaw versus nothing but the hacksaw. This end of the pipe has a remnants of a cast iron pipe fitting of some sort on it, and I don't need that on there, and I don't want it on there because I need to cut this off right at the threads, but this thing gets in the way of the bandsaw table. So what I'm doing, I sliced one side through to the threads. I'm going to slice this side, and I should be able to split this thing because this is just cast iron. There. Now I can put this in the bandsaw and cut the threads off. I'm using one of these Harbor Freight surface conditioning tools with a big wire drum to clean up all the loose paint off this pipe and some of the mud that's caked on it. I'm not trying to take all the paint off. I figure if this thing doesn't take it off, it's stuck on there well enough for my purposes. I just want the blistering paint and the flaking paint off of here. That's looking good right there. The top piece, I cut a saddle joint in it, butted it up against the vertical member, and I just welded it in. Now I can go ahead and lay out for the diagonal reinforcing piece. I'm drilling the holes in the upper adjuster mounting plate and the plate that's going to go on the C-frame to hold the upper adjuster. And I'm doing it at the same time so that way the holes line up. And the way I'm keeping everything lined up is I tack welded the two mounting plates together. So that way I know if I drill the holes at the same time, they're going to line up. Now, one thing I need to do is make sure these plates maintain this orientation when I weld one to the frame and one to the adjuster. And to do that, what I did is I took the cutoff wheel from the grinder and I cut a V-shape on it. There it is, right there in the top of it. So that way I know as long as this V-shape remains when I bolt it together, all these holes will line up. I've laid things out on the floor in a way that will hopefully explain how this is going to work. I'm working on the upper adjustment assembly right now. There's an inner part, which is this, and there's an outer part that is this. This is the upper wheel for the thing. It's going to be turned 90 degrees to where it is right now, so instead of flopped like this, it would be standing up, and it bolts onto this plate right here. This is a piece of 2-inch by 2-inch square tube that is going to go into this 3x3 tube that has these set screws in it, which take up the play in here, so it'll be able to slide up and down without rattling around in there. In order to raise it up and down, I have this hand wheel that's going to go up here, and that is going to attach to this piece of Acme threaded rod right here, and I'm holding it with a pair of pliers because it's hot right now, because I just welded that nut onto this plate. And what that's going to do is, if I put it right in here, when I center it, I will now be able to weld that in, so when I turn the hand wheel, the threaded rod will be able to retract or extend this piece in here. So what I need to do is eyeball this for center. I think if I tip it like that, it automatically centers itself. Now I can put a couple tack welds in it. Now what I want to do is just extend that a little bit and eyeball it to see if this threaded rod looks like it's running parallel to the long axis of this inner piece. If it's not exactly perfect, I think it'll be okay. There's enough slop in this nut right here that it should be able to take care of it, but I want to make it as close as possible. And if I look, that looks straight this way and this way. So I think I lucked out on that. What I do want to do before I weld it all the way out is unthread this rod, because I don't want to get spatter on it, because there's two more nuts that need to go on this assembly. Now that I have it tacked in all four corners, I can go ahead and weld all the way around. I want to make this part strong because this is what is going to apply the down pressure on the wheels. I'm ready to do the final assembly of the upper adjustment mechanism, so this is really the last chance we have to look inside this thing. The way it's set up, it's a 3-inch by 3-inch square tube that has a 3/8 wall. The inner tube that moves up and down that you saw me weld the nut onto and the plate is 2-inch by 2-inch. The inside opening of this square tube measures 2 1/4 by 2 1/4. The reason I chose this tube is that gave me an extra 1/4 inch inside here. To take up that 1/4 inch, I cut two pieces of 1/8 inch thick steel, this one and this one, and welded them in to these two sides. That took up 1/8 inch in this direction and 1/8 inch in this direction. Next, to take up the rest of the distance and to give myself adjustability as things wear in the future, I drilled holes and welded on nuts for these Allen head bolts that I can use to adjust the pressure, pushing the inner part towards the other two walls. And then I put jam nuts on them so that way they don't loosen up and move as I'm wheeling. That's what it's like inside here. And of course that all got welded on to the mounting plate that you saw me drill holes in at the drill press earlier. Now what I need to do is attach this thing. Now this is the threaded rod adjuster that is going to move the inner piece up and down to adjust the pressure on the wheel. The way I built this broke a few rules of machine design. First, you're really not supposed to have threaded rods running through something where they rotate. The reason for that is the threads will wear down over time and you'll get a sloppy fit. Really, if I was doing this right, I should have machined off the threads where it goes through here, so you had a smooth rod going through a smooth hole. I didn't do that. The other thing is I tack welded the nut on the bottom and I tack welded the nut on the top. What that means is once I weld this whole thing to this, the only way to get this threaded rod out of there is going to be to cut it off. Ideally, it would be pinned or have a set screw, something that I could go in there and service it. But the thing is, I don't think I'm going to be able to wear this thing out. And honestly, for the price, I'll just cut this thing off and weld a new piece on if that ever happens in the future. With that said, I'm going to put some grease on here, thread it in, and then weld it to the top of this, and the upper adjustment mechanism will be complete. I'm in the process of adding this diagonal brace right here to this corner. I'm not doing it for strength reasons. There's absolutely no way this corner joint is ever coming apart. I'm doing it to try and reduce the flexing in this frame. This is a pretty big frame, and I'm afraid it might flex too much. Now, an English wheel needs to have a little bit of flex, otherwise you're not going to be able to roll over lumps in the panel because it'll be so rigid. Those lumps just won't fit through the wheels. So it needs a little bit of springiness, but not too much. To be honest, I don't know how much is too much and how much is too little without trying the thing. So I'm going with diagonal brace in this corner, reinforcement on the back, but I'm going to leave the rest of this bottom piece alone. So that way any flex that needs to happen can happen here. I have the English wheel flipped completely upside down and suspended from the ceiling using this electric hoist. And what that allows me to do is weld the legs on upside down and then be able to flip it over, because it would be very awkward to try and get these legs welded on with the thing flipped around. And there's no style points in welding, so if you have the ability to maneuver the piece in a way that's going to let you be more comfortable welding, your welds are going to be better than if you're scrunched up on the floor trying to weld this thing upside down. I'm ready to make the two sides for the lower wheel holder, and I want them to be adjustable so that way if I don't get it perfectly square, I can adjust the bottom wheel one way or the other to compensate. To do that, I'm using a coupling nut in between two pieces of steel, and these two pieces of steel are just like these. When they go together with the coupling nut in the middle, I get the perfect spacing here for the shaft that's on these lower wheels. And with the coupling nut, I'll be able to use a carriage bolt as a big set screw to adjust the two sides up and down to make sure it's parallel with the top wheel. The issue I have is this is 3/8 thick steel, and as you can see, the sidewalls of these coupling nuts are really thin. So if I turn the welder up hot enough to actually dig into these two pieces, I'm going to blow away the coupling nut, and I need to preserve the inside of the coupling nut so that way this bolt will thread in. So instead of welding it, I'm going to go ahead and braze it with some bronze brazing rod.
So I wasn't happy with what the Miko Midget was doing. The biggest tip I have for it just wasn't big enough for brazing 3/8 thick steel. So I have swapped it out for the Victor 40 torch. Let's see what this can do. Now I'll let that cool before removing the clamp, so that way as this thing tries to pull up on either side, the clamps are there to keep it squashed down. Once it's cooled down, I'll flip it around, clamp it again, and braze the other side, just so that way it's not trying to forever warp up or down. I've got the lower anvil holder installed. I've got it adjusted with the two set screws, so that way it's parallel to the bottom of the upper wheel, so it's not tipped one way or the other. And what I then proceeded to do was find a random piece of sheet metal. This is some 26 gauge ductwork, but any sheet metal will work for this. And I went ahead and started wheeling it a little bit. The reason I did that is I need to check two more adjustments. Adjustment number one is that this upper bolt, which is the axle for the upper wheel, is parallel with the axle on the lower wheel. If they're not parallel, when I start rolling this with the spacers removed in here, this whole top wheel would actually slide side to side. So, as an example, if I push it this way, if the axles weren't parallel, this would try to roll either out this way or in this way. And then when I pull it backwards, it would go in the other direction. So you'd see this wheel go back and forth as I roll this thing. To correct that, all you do is loosen up the bolts and twist this thing one way or the other until it stops going side to side. Once it stops going side to side, you know that this axle is parallel with this axle. At that point, you tighten it down, it's good to go. The final thing we want to check is that the contact pattern is in the center of this upper wheel and in the center of the lower wheel. Now, it's pretty much a given because these are full radius dies that it's always going to be in the center of the lower wheel unless something really is out of whack here side to side. This one, on the other hand, you got to check to see how lined up it is. In this case, it's centered. If it wasn't centered, this yoke has slots in the mounting holes that can slide side to side, or I could always put shim stock in here to move it out a little bit if this was in too far. If the lower die was in too far, I'd simply shim the bottom to get it out. But in this case, I had these slots, I was able to adjust it that way, so now it tracks in the center, it's parallel, it's good to go. All I have to do now is paint this thing.